Ladies and gentlemen, it is my great pleasure and privilege to welcome the frontman of Midnight Oil. You being minister, What are you kind of the most proud of? What is your biggest achievement? You haven't probably, you wouldn't do otherwise if you would have just stayed a musician.
Well, going from music to into politics is a step that many people probably think about, but not many people do. And in some ways, it's a recognition that something that happens in pop music is really a fantasy. It's the fantasy of someone on a stage singing songs. They're your hero. You don't have to know them. You don't have to know how they vote or what they really think. They probably say something from their heart, which is great. They may say something that you agree with. That's fine. But you're relating to them as an artist and as a musician. Leave that bubble and go to the total exposure of being in a political party, with the disciplines of politics, where you're accountable for all of your actions. But you've been this person in the bubble.
Right.
And in Australia, at least, you're going to get kicked around for a while. So,
like, what do you mean? Like, half of the people won't talk to you?
Yeah, half the people don't talk to you. That's okay. The Conservatives don't talk to you.
Sure.
I'm not missing much. if you want to make that change that I wanted to make, and particularly for climate change, Veronica, was the issue that I went into the Parliament for, then you take that step. Now, you've asked me what am I proud of? Surviving. taking the Japanese to the International Court of Justice because
right.
They were killing whales in the name of science. Unfortunately, our two countries are a long way away from one another, so we don't have an intimate knowledge about each other's
You
politics.
Mean Japan and Australia?
No, I mean Czech Republic and Australia.
But it's not that bad.
No, it's good, but to
we
talk
know,
about...
We know of you.
And we changed the education system
with
the Prime Minister. We introduced something which... I don't know whether you have this here. I'll ask you this question. It's my turn. Do you have...
it's not your turn yet.
The boss. Do you have a Dwat Suite, I think it's called in Europe? So it's a secondary copyright. Artists and so, well, let me explain it quickly.
Sure.
If someone writes a book or writes a film or something like that, in most countries they have a copyright in that and they'll receive a small royalty.
Yes.
When it's reproduced. There's what's called a secondary royalty in some countries, I think they have it in some parts of Europe, for an artist, a painter or a sculptor. If they sell the work, the first time they sell the work, maybe it sells for 200 euros. The work gets sold again and then again. And over their lifetime, they may see the price go up. It may sell for 10,000 euros, 20,000 euros. They should be able to receive a very small percentage of that secondary sale. In Australia, our indigenous painters, Aboriginal people, are great painters. And they have used art, and some of you may have seen the dot paintings that they do with those dots turning round and round. They've used their painting as a way of communicating their culture to Europeans like myself. And sometimes those paintings would be sold for $50 or $20. And later on for $100,000, they became very famous. So they received some money from that. This was vigorously opposed by our opponents. Vigorously opposed by auction houses and art galleries, and that we did that legislation. So that's another one.
I mean, the life and well-being of the indigenous communities has always been a big part of your life, both professional, both music and political. It all started, if I'm not mistaken, in 1986 when the Midnight Oil Band went on a long tour kind of into inner Australia and had a chance to meet the indigenous people on a much closer base, also collaborating with them as artists. So would you maybe recall that kind of life-changing experience which turned later into your album, Leaves and Dust, and basically international golden face?
Well, that's a really good question where you've summarized it very well. And we were very lucky to take that journey. It's hard to describe what it's like to travel for 1,000, 2,000 kilometers to a part of the country where you have no experience of, to meet with people whose English is not the first language.
Kind of coming from this middle class,
yeah,
big city environment.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
And I think they gave us much more than we gave them. It changed the way in which we thought about our own music. It made us realize that there are many imperatives in Western society and Western culture which don't necessarily allow us to listen carefully to what's happening around us. It was very quiet there. And the culture is the oldest continuous existing culture on Earth. I think Strava has its 750th birthday, if I'm correct. We've just had some recent science in a very important international science publication. We're going towards 80,000 years of continuous occupation. It's totally incredible. And we were lucky, you know, we had this opportunity to travel there. And as you say, we came back and we changed the way that we made our music. Rob and Jim and Martin, look, we listened to the music and then we slowed ourselves up a little bit. We weren't listening to what was on the radio. We didn't care about who was successful. We just really tried to dig a little bit deeper. And we were lucky that we got some songs up that people listened to.
Well, what did you find out there? What was so surprising for you back then?
This is such a... I want to give such a short answer to what is such a complex question. I wonder if I can indulge myself for a second to try and explain, at least from my perspective, and I've spent many years now since then. I mean, maybe I come to the end. This experience was so important for us that we maintained our connection with Aboriginal people up to now.
Okay.
So for me, when I was in government, and since then, even before I came to this tour, I'm spending time out there. So it's been very important. However, think about it in this way. It's a belief system which links the landscape and the person's relationship to both where they live and to every other person in a very intimate, direct way. So it's unlike most cultural belief systems. And we had no knowledge of that. It's complex. It's very sophisticated. And it's not egocentric and built upon the hero model, which a lot of Western culture is.
And which is a model you don't believe in, if I understand well.
Yeah, that's right. So I already started to think about this before I went into the bush. Because I think for all of us, there's a point where you think to yourself, well, who am I? Am I the kind of person that can relate to the time that I've grown up in? Sure, I had lots of friends. I had a happy upbringing. I was lucky to be in a happy family. But I realized that I reject this idea that I think is quite prevalent in our culture, that we'll be rescued by a hero. This is what a rock star is. This is what Trump thought he was.
And, but that's what who you are as well.
Yeah, and this is the irony of it. You're quite right, as we were discussing on the way in. I know I'm seen like that, but I don't feel like that. And my way of thinking about things is to think about how do you make a connection in art and music and performance? How do I make a connection with what I'm hearing around me on the stage? The music that my colleagues are making and the songs that we're writing and that they're writing. In working with people, how do I make a connection with that person? Not as an advancement of my own interest, simply so I can see my name up in lights.
Did the situation improve? Because it's 30 years ago. So, are there more people in business or in politics in Australia taken from those communities? Can you see those concrete results?
Yeah, look, Australians will know that I'm about to give a yes and no answer. So I think in some things, the answer is yes. And we do have more people in business and politics. But in some ways, excuse me, we still have a long way to go, particularly particularly with young Aboriginal kids in prison and high levels of suicide amongst many young people in remote areas. And we still, as a country, as a nation, we still haven't properly acknowledged the fact that we were part of the British that arrived there on their boats, moved in, took that land. There's no recognition of that in our constitution. We have no treaties. We have no agreements with Aboriginal people yet. So that work still has to be done.
When we stop for a second with your sort of landmark hit, Beds Are Burning, are you going to play it tonight? that's not an answer.
I think it's hard not to play it and get out of town. Yeah, we're going to play it tonight.
You know, I have seen...
Four chords.
Pictures from your tour, because you have been touring for 3.5 months now, and there's also your playlist, and there obviously this song is there. You just call it Bass, which is nice for short. And I think it's a great example for a discussion of what comes first, if the music or the message, because I don't know if we here in the Czech Republic get the message, but we certainly do get the music.
Well, that's okay, and I don't think it's our job to prescribe what an audience should think or feel about anything, really. I'm very convinced that we have to say what we think, because there are too many cowards who aren't saying what they think. But that's another story. The music comes first. It's the rhythm, it's the sound, it's the texture. And then you lay into that the lyric. If it's about something which has a specific meaning, people may understand it, and they may get that, but they may not, and things are capable of being read in certain ways. So you really, to be honest, they go together, Veronica, but once you've created a piece of work as an artist, I think this is our view, it's the world's. The world will take it. The world may put it in the dustbin. The world may pretend that they understand it and tell me what it's all about. And the world will take them many different ways at different times.
I think you have a very specific way of writing new songs, don't you? Because there's always credited more than one person, or very often. It's always two or three people. So does it mean that the band kind of works in a commune way?
I think that's a part of the way we work. Yeah, I think we certainly agree to share whatever we can make. And when we first started, we wanted to make sure that people who came to see us weren't exploited or ripped off. But we've got some strong songwriters in the band. Jim Magini, the guitar player and keyboard player, is a very, he's a deep musician. Rob Hurst, our drummer, is a great songwriter. So we've always, sometimes someone's bringing an idea in, and as a band, this expression jamming, bands will jam, and sometimes something will come up. Other times, it won't go anywhere. Sometimes someone will bring in a whole song. Sometimes I'll get a hold of the lyric and turn it around. I think the key to it for us is much the same as performance. Try and find that spot where the idea hasn't been reduced in any way, but it's become midnight oil. And when it's midnight oil, it's got a strength or a force that is very important to us, and it means that when we go onto the stage, we can really play the thing with conviction.
You sometimes ask each other, is it oil, right?
We ask ourselves that question quite a lot.
But can you explain it to us closer? What does it really mean? First of all, what does actually the midnight oil expression mean?
It's just an English expression. It's burning the midnight oil. It means basically staying up late, like it's a candle. So staying up after midnight, burning the midnight oil, so being up late. So for me, having that name as a band was particularly relevant when I became a government minister, and I found that when I was a musician, I was going to bed at 4 a.m. When I was a government minister, I was getting up at 5 a.m. Terrible.
So you were burning the bend of consciousness, the activism has been an important part, and doesn't really matter as we just agreed here whether the message is first or the music is first. But I want to stop by to make one more stop in the sort of history of Midnight Oil, and that's the 2000 closing ceremony of the Sydney Olympics, because I think it has been a very important performance, which I think could not have been done without a lot of little preparations beforehand, like maybe the 1990 Exxon building performance in New York, in front of the Exxon building. So would you recall, like, what was the reason you decided to perform in those in the Sydney Olympics, and what impact did it really have?
Well, I think even from our early period as a band, when we were much younger, I don't know if you know this expression, culture jamming, but in any event, take the music and the message, whether they come first or second, you're quite right, put it here, and then decide what you're going to do. Are you simply just going to play performances and go to the club or to the theatre, or are you going to go and find people who feel the same way that you do, activists, community groups, people in jail, and go and play to them in those places? And so we started to do that, and we became accustomed to playing what you might say scratch gigs. Like tonight, you'll see us with the big PA and the lights, and you know, we've got wonderful road crew to help us, but we also would just turn up with two amps and, you know, just something on the back of a truck to play. In 2000, Sydney hosted the Olympics, and at that time, our then Prime Minister was refusing to apologise to the first Australians, the Indigenous people, on principle, for what had happened. His reasoning being that he wasn't actually personally responsible, because he wasn't born in 1788 or whatever. A very flimsy argument. And it was a big debate in Australia. We decided that he should, and the country should say sorry. And so we dressed in sorry suits on black overalls. We did the trial for the global broadcast in other black suits, which didn't have sorry on them. And then on the night, we wore the black suits, and then we took them off, and then there were the black suits with the sorry, and we played the performance at the closing ceremony. And you know, it was a very big global audience, and it was one of those times when you realise that you are actually punching into the popular consciousness. It wasn't totally popular in Australia for us to do that. There were still people who said, what is Midnight Oil doing? They're always on about politics. But most people now, some years later, agree that it was the right thing to do.
Right. I mean, when Midnight Oil are much more than just a band, you just said, I mean, you are also much more than just a singer. And when we start with one thing, like who taught you to dance? Where does your dancing come
from? No one can teach you.
It looks like an epileptic fit somewhere.
Said this before, and this is really not for Midnight Oil fans to listen to. I don't want to destroy the magic or whatever it is. But if there are any artists here or people that enjoy making music, even just by themselves, I mean, I am happy to say that I think I have learned one or two things. One thing I've learned is to be a child. And I know it sounds very corny and sort of hippie and silly, but actually you have to forget everything that you know, and you have to forget what you're doing. And I do not think about my dancing, probably a good thing.
We'll never forget.
Of course.
I mean, you just reminded me one thing that, you know, in the very beginning of your career, when you kind of applied for the advertisement, you know, that the band, which was called A Farm, right away back then, was looking for a singer. There were many possibilities for you open very soon in terms of performing on the television and, you know, in those popular programs and stuff. And you guys just kept refusing all of it. Like, what kind of statement was that back then? In terms of maybe, you know, the financial security and also being a working band, really.
I mean, it's easy to make sense of things when you look back on them.
Right.
It would be the same for everyone in the room. That's why I made that decision with work or school or to go somewhere on a holiday or some development in my life. It all makes sense when you look at it from hindsight. It's not necessarily that easy to see through the fog when you're starting out. But one thing we were very clear about, and I was very clear about, was that we were in a business, and it's a highly competitive business, and it rewards success. So we don't want the government to give us any money. We don't need any subsidies. But the business will just chew us up, like it's chewed up just about every other person that you can name. John Lee Hooker, to Elvis, to whoever. So you have to try imperfectly to find your own pathway. And that means you don't care too much about the money. You have to feed yourself and your people. And it also means that you try and do things on your own terms. And in a way, that was very helpful for us because it taught us to be self-reliant. We became our own promoters with a manager that was working with us at the time. So we would promote our shows. We understood marketing. We understood contracts. I'm a lawyer, so I read the contracts. And for our fellow colleagues, we were really, really deadly dull and boring people. We were so un-rock. You know, this rather silly idea of the rock rebel, you know, that still has currency and usually just mucks people up. We were focused intensely on our music, trying to write great songs, playing in all these places every night, arguing and doing deals and working with business people and backing people off and really scrapping our way, you know, for 10 or 11 years, in debt most of the time. Now, I'm not saying that everybody can do it like that, and I think we were lucky in many ways, the time that we lived in, but it meant that we, and we still do, exist on a parallel line from the recording industry and the business. And it's healthy for us. This is the only way that we can work.
But you are a working band again now. Just touring the world instead of touring Australia. So how does it feel to kind of hear, you know, the rhymes and your songs kind of amongst the people again? Because I'm assuming that many of those songs are quite sort of historically popular and old in a way. There'll be songs from the 70s and 80s. So, how does it make you
feel?
Maybe
not the
70s,
years? But certainly the 80s.
Yeah,
and
90s. Yeah.
Yeah. Look, no, but it's amazing. It's amazing. I mean, when we got together and said, "Can we come and play again?"
You mean last year?
Yeah.
Hi.
Who is it?
Hi.
Hi, man.
Yeah,
oh yeah, okay, I know where you guys are from. That's right. It's friendly forces and friendly faces. No, we really just got in a room and, you know, you have to ask yourself this question. Can people who have been making music for a long time, who've been apart for a while, or especially with me, find something which justifies coming out to play again? And we needed to feel more passionate, more urgent, more driven by it than our audience for it to work. And then when we started to run the songs down, we listened to the songs and think, how's this happened? You know, this song sounds like it was written yesterday. And then, of course, we had to start to play, and you don't know what's going to happen when you play. It's a bit of there's an alchemy or some kind of mystery in that. It could sound terrible, you know, and not work, but it didn't. It sounded fine. And I think that from that point on, it's just been amazing the way that audiences have reacted and the shows have been stronger and longer than ever.
Well, they are. Some songs are, you know, as relevant as ever, like the Cold Cold Change, for example. I think what's interesting about your tour is that when you decided to do it last May, like, we didn't know anything about the contemporary world yet, right? It was before Brexit.
Yeah.
It was before Donald Trump was elected. So I was wondering, what is your reflection of touring both in Europe and in the US now, and the reaction of the people to your songs, and also to you being outspoken, really?
Yeah, well, look, I think that you're right. We had no idea, and who could have predicted any of this, really? In some ways, with art and life, they've got a way of colliding and turning back on themselves. Sometimes they can make a fool out of you. Sometimes they can make you seem really smart, and you can never really say which one it's going to be. So it just happens to have been the way the timing has worked that Midnight Oil songs should be heard now. When it comes to Trump, maybe I'll do Trump and Brexit separately. So when it comes to Trump, I think for Americans they were still in shock when we got there, and they've got quite a lot of respect for their presidential position. But I had no respect for it at all. And I was happy to say so. And I think that was a bit surprising to people. But as the weeks went on, my thinking about Trump went from seeing him as an ogre. And I mean, there's still a great deal of danger with the Trump presidency. There's no question about that. But I think that he's been so spectacularly unsuccessful and achieved zero, despite being one of the most powerful people on the planet. And by the way, they have control of the houses, of the Congress and the Senate. They have control. There's nothing to stop them doing anything, really. It's not like many countries. I'm not sure exactly what happens with yours here, but However, the point is, there's nothing stopping him being Trump, but he is too ignorant, too vain, too narcissistic, too stupid to even be Trump.
Cheers.
So what does that mean? What it means is that it gives people, particularly in America, the opportunity to regroup, to rethink, to renew, to stake their claim on the kind of country and the kind of world that they want, and to make sure that they get it, because they can see so clearly how awful the alternative is.
Well, I think you should be proud or feel successful that they even let you into the country, given the fact who the Secretary of State of the US now is, because it's a guy who had been working for Exxon for many, many years, and Exxon is the company.
Awesome.
Exxon is the company you have been standing in front of in 1990, rebelling against the ecological catastrophe they have done in Alaska. So congratulations that you can still like, work there.
Still gotta go back.
It's for the second round. Right?
Yeah, that'll be more interesting.
In terms of, I mean, you call it maybe chemistry in between the group, and what did the other colleagues do for the 15 years you have spent in politics? Because I'm assuming, or I know actually, they have stayed in music mostly.
They're music makers, and Rob, Jim and Martin had a band. Well, they went looking for a singer, but they couldn't find one. Anyway, they had an instrumental band, which they called The Break. And our bass player, Bones Tillman, went to work in Nashville. So some people will know the Violent Femmes, the band The Violent Femmes. So their bass player played in The Break. So that was a surf band. They made their own solo records. And they had side projects producing younger bands.
Hmm.
And basically, you know, just doing lots of music.
But is this something you always wanted to do, to reunite the band? Kind of hoping for? Or did it just kind of happen out of...
Not boredom. I think we knew that I went quickly when I did finally go, and we probably hadn't really fully had a chance to contemplate what life without Midnight Oil would be like. And as it turned out, there was a life without Midnight Oil, but at the same time, everybody still was in contact with one another. And I mean, look, I then made a record of my own when I came out of politics, which I never expected to do. I said the only band I ever want to sing in is Midnight Oil, you know, but I had songs, so I did that. And in some ways, that was quite good for me because it meant that I rediscovered music slowly. And then once the Oils were in the same room together, I could hear this glorious sound, and it's not something you can run away from.
That's actually very interesting that you did a solo album and in the same time you decided you wanted to reunite with the band. So is there any connection that you kind of felt that one solo album was enough and you wanted to be...
I didn't, honestly, they're just simple folk songs turned electric. I never really expected to do it. And I was on my way, Martin Rotzi and I had been out in the desert, visiting Aboriginal communities, Indigenous people. And out of that, I had some songs, so I came back and did them. No, I just think that you have to consider yourself, it's like a partnership, whether it's a relationship, or a marriage, or a partnership of whatever sort. If you find one person, or two people, or three people, or you're in a family, or a business, or whatever it might be, where you do respect one another and you can work effectively almost no matter what, you should cherish that. And I think we're incredibly fortunate, and I feel incredibly fortunate to have that. So for me, I feel like I don't look like it, I know that, but I feel like I'm a kid in the sandpit. And I'm just like a kid at school, and I'm in the sandpit, and these things are coming around me, and I can share that with other people. That's all I've heard.
Thank you. And yet you have been an active member of the Australian Parliament for 10 years, served two terms as a minister of two different industries. How does your personal belief conflict with the sort of, cabinet solidarity, I would say, in terms of being outspoken versus being a team player? And
I couldn't be as outspoken as I could be if I was outside the parliament. But I understood that, and I accepted that. And I'm a student of politics, and I worry about politics where people allow their own egos to be more important than the policies of the party. And I'm very hardline about this, and I was very hardline with my colleagues. I think that discipline and loyalty and cabinet solidarity are very important. That's how governments get things done. If you don't like what they're doing, okay, vote them out. But it's not an arena for you to parade your own views or thoughts or pretend to be more or less virtuous than other people. And it requires a high level of public service and a high level of accepting that people are going to think that you're a piece of shit sometimes. But you just have to do it. And I was prepared to do it. I have no regrets for doing it. Not everybody understands it. I don't expect everybody to understand it. But I was a strong supporter of our Labor Party in Australia, like a Social Democrat Party. And I'd seen the Labor Party be successful and unsuccessful. And it was unsuccessful when people were undisciplined and followed their own agendas. And the value set was as close to my value set as I was going to find.
But, and also you have left the politics kind of based on your personal decision quite abruptly, right? It was a couple of hours after a big education proposal of yours had been accepted. And then you left as a hero. I know you don't like to be a hero, but it was an heroic sort of leave. So would you recall what was happening back then in the politics?
That's painful. look, you know, to understand successful policy making is to see how sausages are made. You know, there's nothing entertaining about it. But we worked very hard for 2 years, and we changed the education system, really so that any kid in any school would get a good chance for learning. And I think in Czech Republic, it's something people understand. You're a well-educated nation. The Prime Minister at the time was a woman who'd taken that role from a man, a male leader. I supported her. I thought she was a person of credibility. That male leader who was deposed, you know, was like Shakespeare or your equivalent here, and schemed and fought to get back and eventually destroyed her and came back. And I had said, if he comes back, I won't serve. And so when he came back, literally the day after my major work was completed, so I thought, well, I've done my job.
And you are coming back to music after 27 years of the Midnight Oil existence and 14 albums. So, yes, it is. Are you thinking about a new album for the band?
Look, we might do one. We may not. I'm not sure. I think
do it.
There's plenty of creativity, obviously, in the band, and the one thing about the industry is it has changed a great deal, as people would know, particularly with record sales, file sharing, Pandora, Spotify, all of that, and you can let music out in all sorts of different ways now, so I think we'll finish the tour, and I'm sure there'll be ideas there, but we'll just take each day as it comes, you know, if you plan too far ahead. I mean, in some ways, look at it this way. Not spending too much time looking over your shoulder to either regret or celebrate the past, and not spending that much time looking forward to project into the future. I'm a really strong believer that in our culture, and in our business in particular, where everybody wants someone to succeed, that projection is like a pair of handcuffs that you wear. Let's just see what happens on the day. We'll walk into a room, we might do it.
You know, Mr. Garrett wrote this wonderful memoir called Big Blue Sky. I think you started writing it in 2013 after you left the politics, right? I have listened to it as an audiobook. You know how long it is? It has 14 hours and 55 minutes.
Yeah, that's very long.
But like everything is there from the very beginning to the 2013. Trying to cover also a little bit what happened after that. Unfortunately, we don't have that much time. We will have to end up this session in 10 minutes. So I was wondering if Mr. Gerd, you are ready for it, and
Peter.
If you guys are ready for it, do you have any questions from rock to politics and back? Are you interested in knowing something? There is a microphone floating there, Maya. It's towards the end. So please speak into the microphone.
I will, Peter. How are you?
Yeah, I'm good, mate.
I was trying not to be cliched, but anyway. Look, a simple question. You've been all around the world, you've met all these different cultures, and if you had a chance to talk to a 21-year-old self, what advice would you give yourself now looking back?
Oh, isn't that a good question? Translated. Dig deeper and go further. That's it.
The gentleman in the middle.
Hey Peter, my name is Jan. What took you so long?
That's a good question too.
Of bands I'm never ever going to see again as The Clash, The Ramones, and now you are here, so shame on you for keeping us waiting for so long, but at the same time...
anyway, I'm sorry, man, I'm sorry.
Show the sorrow tonight, you know, do a good show.
Basically, the question is, are you coming back, if I'm understanding?
Anyway, here's the question. We don't have here in the Czech Republic too many musicians, sportsmen, artists who actively comment on society issues, environmental issues, painful issues. I guess it's maybe because the moment they do it, quite many people say... quite many people say, hey, stick to your business.
Yeah, that's right.
I guess, did you receive those comments during your career, and how did you react? What did you say?
Yeah. Yeah, good question. Thanks, Jan. Yeah, people do say that, and I guess it didn't stop us from saying things. It doesn't stop me from saying something. But I do think that people will make an assessment about whether or not you're serious about something or you have some knowledge or background to speak. So everyone has a right to speak. Freedom of speech is one of the most important freedoms of all. But to be making a statement from a vantage point such as mine, you also have a responsibility, I think, to be well informed. Now, not everybody is going to agree, and as some of my Australian colleagues will know, there'll be people who would have vehemently disagreed with me or the oils on some things, and strongly agreed with us at other times, and sometimes changed their mind in between. Finally, though, I do want to make a bigger point which pertains to Europe and other countries as well. The way in which we see human rights is very important here, because human rights is not an abstract. Human rights is a concrete, and free speech along with free exercise of religion and conscience and ensuring that all of our institutions, countries and so on are looking at people as equal sovereign agents on the planet. 8 billion, whatever, it's not, the number's not important, it's the principle that's important. For me, it's the most important thing of all. So even if I was blowing you-know-what out of my you-know-where, I still had every right to get up and say that, and I would insist on that to this day.
Welcome back, Peter.
Good
to hear the music from Midnight Oil. I know you've still got a tour of Australia and you've been travelling, so excellent. One question I have, you talked about that you haven't got an album that you're interested in writing yet, but if there was one topic or one passion that you may have to think about, whether it be internationally or Australia, what would you write about?
They're doing a great job, aren't they, Veronica?
Yes, they are.
That's another cracker, which is an Australian expression for good question. And the answer is, we don't write to topic specifically, but we certainly write about the things that we see. And if you look at a song like Robert's Forgotten Years, you know, incredible anti-war song, Jim's One Country. I think it'd be about the Great Barrier Reef. And the fact that, so you know the Great Barrier Reef, the very large coral reef off the coast of Australia. It's the largest living natural organism on the planet. You can see it from outer space. We've had two terrible coral bleaching events there where the sea water's temperature gets too high and the corals die. It employs many people, it generates a lot of income for Queensland. It's a thing of extraordinary beauty. And the earlier question about nature and our connections to the world, which is important to me, it's one of the most key examples of that I can think. So the Great Barrier Reef, making sure you do a good job.
There's a gentleman right here and then the lady. Go ahead.
Good evening, Peter. Good evening. I have a kind of easy going for you now. I'm not going to talk about politics. I have to follow you all around Europe because you're never coming around Austria, so I just wish to ask you which criteria did you guys use to pick up your countries you're playing around Europe? Was it an easy one? Was not a cracker, right?
Sorry, just say the last bit again.
That's not a cracker one. I mean, which was your criteria you used?
The criteria?
Yeah.
Oh, I see.
To pick up the countries you're
playing around. I don't know if there was a criteria, actually, right. I mean, we did want to come here earlier on, and we just never quite made it. You're right, we've gone from A to B, and we've crisscrossed. I don't know, I don't know what the criteria is, I think. Who knows? But we're happy to be here. I'm glad we finally made it.
In the white.
Hi, could you please comment on Brexit?
On Brexit? I'll make the comment quick because there's another
girl
over here that had a question. I think Brexit is going to be the end of the poms. Well, if you want me to expand.
We'll elaborate it a little bit, yeah.
Okay, we live in a highly globalized, macro trading economic environment. And there's more, the English have far, far more to lose from being out of Brexit than what they'll have to gain by allegedly having control of their own borders. So I think it's a backward move. It was fueled by this frustration with conventional politics, which I understand. Its pace, its compromises sometimes, its inability to cut through, but they cut through with crap, with meaningless slogans, silly, fearful kind of ideology, and anything that's based on that is doomed to fail.
Hello, good evening, Peter. My question is there still something you would like to change as a politician in your country?
Amongst our politicians, do you mean, or...?
As an active politician.
Oh, as an ex...?
Yes.
There'd be a couple of things. So, they're terribly boring and basic, but they're not about human nature. So I think, really, we can have a view about politicians and politics as being an imperfect science and disappointing, as I said before, and politicians letting us down. Yes, there are good ones and bad ones, and some who care and some who don't, and they're no different to you or I, and that's certainly one thing I learned. So I don't see politics as a way of altering human nature. I think that's work that each individual has to do on themselves. There's surely some there that need to do that work, but that's their responsibility. Now, the one thing I would change in Australia very quickly is such a basic, silly little thing. I would just extend our election terms so that we weren't always fighting elections. So for local Australians, they'll know what I mean. We need to have certainty. And the reason for that, I guess maybe I can explain very quickly. Changing stuff is complicated. There are always winners and losers. Our systems are far more interconnected, both economically and socially, than they have ever been. And that goes even more so for you in Europe, where you have the European Union. And we're on a learning experience on the planet. I take a positive view when I take a long view of history, although I'm very fearful about climate change and issues at the moment. But I take a long view, and the fact of the matter is that, you know, in the past period, the 750 years ago, when Ostrava was first mentioned in a letter from the bishop, or whatever it might be, in most places, not in all places, but in most places, conditions were not as good as they are now. The idea that we should be able to vote, the idea that women have got every, and should have every right to fulfil their full potential, the idea that we would have compassion.
Still a new for us here, you know.
Yeah.
We hardly ever hear it in this.
And we've got a glass ceiling in Australia as well. I'm not saying everything's perfect now. I'm definitely not making that argument. The argument I'm making is that as a generation, we must be careful that we don't fall prey to a pessimism that denies some of the legitimate advances that hard work has been made in the past. And so for me, part of that is having structures that have got heart and soul in them, but also certainty so that people can get on and do the job properly. Fixed terms, these fixed terms.
There's a lady in the blue.
Good evening, Peter. My name is Lenka.
Lenka.
Thank you for having this discussion and also the concert. It's pretty much the reason why I bought the ticket. My question is related to a specific song, which is called Mountains of Burma.
Ah.
It's pretty much, because I also work with Burmese pro-democracy activists, so it pretty much speaks from my own heart.
Yes.
And I wanted to ask you, why Burma in particular? Was there any personal or specific reason? I know it's a specific country, but there's several countries.
Look, Rob brought that one in. It doesn't have a specific link to the issues in Burma at the time. They call it Myanmar now, but we still call it Burma. But it's ironic because I actually visited Burma in the 70s and the 80s. So I've spent a little bit of time in another country, and I was in the parliamentarian support for Burma group in the Australian Parliament. So it can be a soundtrack for those people and for that cause, but it wasn't specifically intended for that reason. Another example of how art and politics both combine and have nothing to do with one another.
Is there a space for a very last question, which has to be the question?
It should be your question.
You always talk about yourself as a team player, or often, and I think we understood today after spending, having the chance to spend 60 minutes with you, that you are a team player. Are you ever coming back to Poledek?
No. Not as far as I know.
Perfect answer, perfect timing. Enjoy the concert tonight.
Yeah,
for
really
the very first time. It's a world premiere.